Charter Day Convocation. These proceedings are being broadcast live on Howard University YouTube channel. Sign interpreting today is being provided by SunX. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the academic procession. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the platform party procession. Standing for the presentation and posting of the colors, which will be followed by the national anthem, Lift Every Voice and Sing, and the invocation. Present the colors.
Curry, colors.
The invocation will be delivered by the Dean of the Andrew Rankin Memorial Chapel at Howard University, the Reverend Dr. Bernard L. Richardson.
You may be seated. Let us pray. Most gracious and loving God, you are the giver of every good and precious gift. We give you thanks for the gift of the 156 years of Howard University. We give you thanks for the visionary leadership of President Wayne A.I. Frederick and the dedicated stewardship of our Board of Trustees. We give you thanks for our outstanding faculty who teach with both head and heart. We give you thanks for our committed staff members, and we give you thanks for the lifeblood of our university, our amazing students, who are not only our future, but also our hope. As we celebrate our founding, we remember that we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses who now rest from their labors, but who made Howard University a beacon of hope and promise to a people, to a nation, and to the global community. As we celebrate, oh God, help us to honor this rich history and those who shaped our history by rededicating ourselves to excellence and sacrificial service. Remind us how blessed we are to be part of this great legacy, and keep ever before us the reasons why we are here. Remind us of our responsibility, our sacred trust, to take the richness of our Howard University experience, to take our creativity, our commitment to truth and service, to take our intellectual resources and distribute them where poverty, injustice, disease, racism, sexism, ignorance, and violence are running rampant. To take what we have learned to corporate boardrooms, political and judicial chambers, to the arts and to the scientific and medical laboratories, seeking not celebrity status, nor individual greatness, but seeking only to serve. Remembering the words of Benjamin Elijah Mays, that if we seek to serve, we will bump into greatness along the way. So help us, O God, to do our work so well that when future generations tell our story, they will say about our president, our Board of Trustees, our faculty, our staff, and our students, that through their seeking to serve, they made a great university even greater. This is our prayer, O God. May it become our legacy. In your name we pray, amen.
Please welcome the 17th president of Howard University, Dr. Wayne A.I. Frederick.
Good morning. So I want to welcome you all to the celebration of the anniversary of the 156th anniversary of the Charter of Howard University, which would have occurred on March 2nd, 1867. The 17th president, Andrew Johnson, signed into existence Howard University, and on that same day, he signed the first Reconstruction Act, vetoed the first Reconstruction Act. Last night, I spent my time reading the statement that he would write as to why he did that. And every reason that he gave for why he would veto the first Reconstruction Act is exactly why Howard University needs to be here, to ensure our freedom for all. And so today, we not just celebrate our great university, but we celebrate our humanity today. I do want to start with the fact that in that humanity is a circle of life. And a couple of days ago, unfortunately, we lost one of our students. And so I'd like us to bow our heads in a moment of silence in her honor and lift our prayers for her family. There's a lot for us to be thankful for in this time. When we think of Howard University and we think of the social ills, we think of the forces against freedom that exist in our society today. The reality is that Howard University is here for that very reason. And so we must continue to make sure that Howard University is strong. And the way we do that is that internally we have to continue to innovate. We have to continue to make sure that we provide excellence for our students, that we participate in research activities that will uncover uncomfortable truths and find solutions that are necessary to make our society a better society. And as we do that, and as we grow and train our own leaders, we have to make sure that we scatter them throughout our society. And so while this is a bittersweet moment, I hope that we all would agree the sweetness of it at the end will win out. And our Dean of our School of Law, Dean Holly, Daniel Holly, will take on the mantleship of the presidency of Mount Holyoke College in July of... And so in one last parting act in recognition of her excellence, I'd like her to come to the podium. She's unaware of this, but it is going to be my humble honor to present her with the Presidential Medal. She's going to make an excellent president. She's an excellent dean of the law school, and so we certainly wish her well. We have a few more in the pipeline, so the rest of the country better get ready. I also want to take this opportunity to thank the cabinet of this great university. They've been an excellent team. A lot of what we've accomplished because of them. So I'd like the cabinet to take a stand. And while at the end I usually acknowledge our guests, I do want to take an opportunity to acknowledge a special guest who's here with us today, Mrs. Patricia Walters. She is the spouse and lifelong partner of Professor Ron Walters, for whom we have an endowed chair in his name because of her generosity. She donated art that they've collected over many years, and I would encourage all of you to go visit our gallery. We have a display of the art called Genesis, that is actually a display of all of the art that she generously donated, multi-million dollars worth of art, which in this era is only getting more and more valuable. So I do want to ask Mrs. Walters to stand and to thank her as well. And before I leave the podium, this is going to be brief. I'm going to try to preserve my voice for tomorrow night as well. But more importantly, I think hearing from our convocation speaker is what's important today. I do want to acknowledge one other person. I came to this university in 1988 and worked in the financial aid office as a student worker. And I worked for this lady who would then subsequently work with me as my chief of staff. That's how she left the university. Her distinguished service to this great institution is part of why I fell in love with it. And so today, the Board of Trustees actually had given me the privilege of starting a Distinguished Service Award for staff, and they doubled down on that when I proposed that we rename the award after her. So I do want to acknowledge Mrs. LaRue Barkwell as well. So I leave you this morning with a heart full of everything Howard, a heart full of everything that epitomizes optimism and hope. I leave you with a heart that's absolutely filled with a relationship that I've developed with this place since 1988, a debt of gratitude that I will continue to try to repay, but a debt of gratitude that I know that I will never be able to fully repay. But the joy and the beauty in my journey is always going to be trying to represent the best of what Howard University is and trying my best to give back to it in every way, shape, and form. Thank you and welcome to Charter Day. The greeting will be delivered by the chairman of the board, Chairman Larry Morse.
Good morning. On behalf of the Board of Trustees, it is my privilege to welcome you to Howard University's 2023 Charter Day Convocation. As I look out into this impressive audience of students, alumni, faculty, staff, and some of the younger members of our community, I want to first acknowledge how grateful I'm certain we must all feel to be able to attend convocation in person at full capacity once again. The past few years have certainly helped put into perspective how much we cherish this community and to the people who make it our home. For weeks and months, this normally bustling auditorium went unoccupied, and so many of us did not know if and when we would be able to return to our beloved hilltop. Today, it brings me great joy to see past, present, and future generations of Howard University coming together to celebrate 156 years since the founding of this historic institution. Charter Day is a time to reconnect with our Howard family. It is a time to celebrate our victories and also a time to give back to a place which has given and will continue to give so much to each of us. Whether you are an alumnus, a current student, a professor, an administrator, or a friend of Howard University, we've all played our parts in the university becoming the global force that it is today. Howard continues to blaze new trails in technology and innovation in all disciplines ranging from politics and business to communications and the arts. We are setting standards for our local communities and the global society at large. From seeds sown through academic experiences in our hallowed halls, the Bison family continues to make an indelible impact on the world. As I look out at each of you this morning, I see the living embodiment of excellence and truth and service. And speaking of the living embodiment of excellence and truth and service, I cannot leave this podium this morning without saying a few words about a certain triple alum and treasured son of this, our beloved Howard University. Although this is not the time or place for me to reprise the litany of challenges that we faced as an institution at the time our current president took the helm of alma mater, suffice it to say that collectively, the threats they posed to Howard were existential. So the extraordinary transformation and change in the fortunes of Howard University that have been accomplished under the leadership and administration of our 17th president have been little short of miraculous. As this may well be the last time I will have the privilege of sharing this stage with him in Crampton Auditorium, I want to ask my fellow trustees, the members of the president's cabinet, faculty, students, alumni, parents, and friends who are with us this morning, to stand and join me in a resounding show of love, respect, and gratitude. Yes, gratitude for the service of Dr. Wayne A.I. Frederick. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President. Because of the great service you have rendered on your watch, we are better prepared than ever before to nurture, support, and continue the work of producing Howard excellence for generations to come. Thank you, and enjoy this Charter Day Convocation.
The Howard University Chorale will perform The Last Words of David, arranged by Randall Thompson, with pianist Dr. Mickey Thomas Terry, and conducted by Dr. Eric Poole. We will now witness the conferring of the honorary doctorate in science and presentation of the convocation orator.
Chairman Morse, please present our speaker, Mr. Gregory L. Robinson, former director of the James Webb Telescope at the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. Gregory L. Robinson, astute and accomplished administrator, pioneering space scientist and engineer, resourceful researcher, visionary humanitarian, the magnitude of your awe-inspiring career of more than three decades at NASA has broken barriers and shattered the glass ceiling in your areas of expertise. Your historic place in the annals of our universe was established when you were chosen in 2018 as director of the James Webb Space Telescope Program, the largest, most powerful space science observatory in history, and in partnership with the European and the Canadian space agencies. More than 10,000 scientists, engineers, as well as universities, organizations, and companies. The project makes it possible to explore the cosmos of 13.5 billion years ago and to see galaxies and planets outside the solar system that orbit stars other than the sun. In addition to gathering more information about the origin and life of our planet, you are credited with raising the program efficiency from 55% to 95% within several months. In your estimation, Webb is an engineering miracle and a human one too. You were named to the 2022 Time 100 list of influential people and 2022 Innovator of the Year, among your numerous other honors. NASA Administrator Bill Nelson said, "Greg is the real deal. He's been a steady hand leading the Webb team through unprecedented challenges and unimaginable successes. His impact at NASA will be realized for generations." Prior to your directorship, your stellar executive achievement at NASA included Science Mission Directorate Deputy Associate Administrator for Programs, overseeing more than 100 science missions and best performance practices, Deputy Center Director at Glenn Research Center in Cleveland, and Deputy Chief Engineer from 2005 to 2013. You also served as the Acting National Environmental Satellite Data and Information Service, Deputy Assistant Administrator at the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, and prior to reassignment to NASA headquarters in 1999. You held various leadership positions at the NASA Goddard Space Flight Center in Greenbelt, Maryland. Your illustrious career continues to set new models for leadership as you inspire students at the Columbia University School of Professional Studies and champion your next phase of life in retirement. The ninth of 11 children born to supportive parents who performed hard work as tobacco sharecroppers in rural Virginia, you excelled in math and science. You credit your family and the excellent teachers who guided and nurtured your development. A full-ride football scholarship led to you earning a Bachelor of Science degree in mathematics from Virginia Union University. You transferred to Howard University to earn a Bachelor of Science degree in electrical engineering, and you earned a Master of Business Administration at Harvard College, and later attended the Harvard Kennedy School as a Senior Executive Fellow. You and your wife, Cynthia, are the proud parents of three adult daughters and of grandchildren whom you hope will follow you in some field of science. No pressure. Gregory L. Robinson, you are an exceptional servant leader whose stewardship, tenacious determination, integrity, fortitude, and sheer strength of spirit are an inspiration to all who reach for the stars. As a beloved son of the capstone who has honored us beyond all expectations, you give new meaning to our cherished core values of leadership, excellence, truth, and service. It is with immense pride, gratitude, and affection that we salute and honor you as orator of the historic occasion of our 2023 Charter Day, conferring upon you the degree Doctor of Science Honoris Causa. Congratulations. And now we'll hear the newly minted Dr. Robinson's address.
My mama used to say, "Great God Almighty." who would have thought? Certainly, first given honor to God, And I think of 1867, and 156 years later, that is really saying something. To Dr. Frederick, Chairman Morse, trustees, faculty, staff, deans, students, guests, it's truly an honor for me to be here. Never thought I would be on this stage, but it's an honor. I want to acknowledge my family and some dear friends, like family. My wife, Cynthia. She's my rock. This year is 40 years of marriage. And I still love her dearly, maybe more than when we met at Virginia Union. Two of my three daughters, my oldest, Adria, my middle one, Brianna, who's a Howard graduate, is here. Her husband and my son-in-law, Sean. So you guys are between me and lunch, so let me finish these. dear friends, Tony and Yvette Williams, also Virginia Union graduates, Frank Peterson III, and Lorenzo Chance. And Frank's wife couldn't make it. She was supposed to be here, Jaslyn. She had a family emergency in India. She was on the first thing smoking yesterday morning, heading out. So thank you all for being here to support me as well. Often get asked, who influenced me while I was at Howard? Who was part of my journey? Of course, there were numerous. I'd like to mention one in particular, and that's Dr. Eugene Deloach. Dr. Deloach was the EE chair at the time. Shortly after that, he went on to found the engineering school at Morgan. And one of Howard's news stations called him the man who created an army of black engineers. And he really did here and at Morgan. Lastly, with family, in the event that my three grandsons are watching live stream, that's Carter, Isaac, and Isaiah. I say hi, Pa says hi, and you go, boys, for sure. Dr. Frederick, I think he mentioned it earlier, but not this morning. Howard recently received the designation of a UARC, University Affiliated Research Center. And if you're not familiar with it, go look it up. It's a really, really, really big deal. Not many institutions around the country have that designation. As a matter of fact, Howard is the 15th and the first HBCU. Of course, they're leading a... leading a large consortium of other HBCUs, but it's a really big deal. I'll talk a little bit more about that a little bit later. I want to give a shout out to the swimming and diving team, the men's team. Also a big deal, we really need to take the time to celebrate, and that's a huge accomplishment. You know, black folks don't float, right? So my friend Lorenzo Chance, I can teach anybody to swim. He doesn't know yet. So when Dr. Frederick asked me to be the speaker today, I didn't say it to him, but I certainly said it to myself, why me? And I'm sure we all ask that question often. How did I get here? That's one of the questions I ask myself a lot, and not just for this program. And I continue those questions. So when I was contacted by Time and Ebony and 60 Minutes and numerous other media outlets around the globe, I continued to ask that question, why me? And how did I get here? And when I saw the list of Time 100, I went down the list real quick and I said, geez, why is that guy on in this list? When you look at all of those people, I mean, that's how we kind of grew up through our careers looking at this. But after really taking some time to think about the huge accomplishment with Webb, and certainly my wife reinforcing why I should be there, then I felt comfortable going to time to participate in their activities. My wife and I often talk about, I talk about it a lot, going back to your roots or roots, depending on where you're from. And I think it's extremely important. We just recently went back to my hometown over the weekend, to Danville. I gave a talk down there to one of my sister's churches, which was a real delight. Going back home helps you rekindle yourself. It helps build clarity, strength. And there's no clarity and strength like coming to the Mecca. And so, and 156 years later, it still gives me strength. It wasn't that long ago when I was here, but. So how did we get here? How did you get here? How did I get here? In 1991, Alida Adams made a song. I won't try to sing it, but I'm gonna just give you a few verses. You can reach me by railway. You all know where I'm going. You can reach me by trailway. You can reach me on an airplane. You can reach me in your mind. You can reach me by caravan. Cross the desert like an Arab man. I said I wasn't going to try to sing this. I don't care how you get here, but get here if you can. So a little bit about my journey. A little black boy growing up in Pennsylvania County, Virginia. We call it down in the country, right on the border of North Carolina, 30 minutes north of Greensboro. Growing up sharecropping, tobacco. Talking to someone recently from the Deep South, and I think he's from Alabama. I forget where Alabama State is, St. Montgomery. And all he knew was cotton, but he grew up picking cotton. So it doesn't matter what the product is or where you grew up. Sharecropping is sharecropping. Often talk about it as being the next step from slavery. So it's a step up, but it's not really where you want to end up. Growing up on a dirt road, I often tell stories when the weather was really rough, the school bus would turn around and not come all the way to pick us up. Some of you know that story. My friends from the big city, I'm sure they had other challenges. And also I started my schooling in segregated schools. And if you happen to see me on The Daily Show with Trevor Noah, he asked me about growing up in the early days, I forget the terms, but with lesser education. And certainly my response was the best education in the world. Many of those teachers had master's degrees before it was fashionable, and PhDs, and couldn't get jobs in the industry, so they nourished us. And of course, they brought alma mater with them, and that was a paddle to take care of what mom and daddy didn't do at the house. So it's been a significant journey to get here. And when I think about it and reflect, it pales in comparison to 1867. It just pales in comparison. And think about it for a minute. Howard, in his first 5 years, educated 150,000 freed slaves. 150,000. And 156 years later, it's still the real HU. You know, just coming out of Black History Month, you know, all the churches do the Black History regalia. And there's always a debate about HU. It was HI when I started school, but it's another whole story. So 1867 was the first leg of a long relay race. I kind of think of the 4x400 when I think of a long, tough, sprinting relay. And I'll talk more about that later, but that was the first leg of this long journey. And now to one of my favorite topics. Dr. Frederick stole 99% of my thunder, but it was good thunder, so we take it when we can get it. I was asked to take over Webb, and actually it was February 2018 when I was asked, and I turned it down many times. And eventually, I decided to take it in March. And it took some convincing, not because it was bad, not because I didn't think I could do it, but I was enjoying my job. And I still ask the question, why me? And how did I get here? So, of course, as always, I consulted with my wife. And eventually she said, well, why not you? Why would it be anyone else? And I knew I was prepared technically, some of that thanks to Howard Beginnings and Virginia Union. I knew I was prepared programmatically. But as an old preacher said way back in the days, he coined the slogan, you can't lose with the stuff I use. I don't use that one much, so I think I need to use it more in my talks. So that gave me the confidence of taking the program, and it was in pretty bad shape, depending who you ask. Even talks in the White House and Congress about terminating, which really would have been a travesty, in my opinion. The greatest telescope in the history of humankind. So through research and exploration, the world has learned many, many things about our universe. We continue to ask the question, and not just astronomers and astrophysicists and physicists, but most humans, where do we come from? How do we fit into this vast universe? And the other question we always ask, are we alone? And I don't have the answer to that, by the way. But Webb will certainly help us peek into some of those mysteries of our universe. And just a short story, not in my notes. After I did the 60 Minutes piece, I got an email from a random woman, because I had no idea who it was. So why are we spending all this money and you're doing all this stuff? And I can tell you, you know, you go to Genesis, and I can tell you, you know, where we came from. And I think it's yes, yes. There's no conflict. When you turn to the Weather Channel, you pull up your radar. My daddy could look at the sun and hear and check out the wind. He didn't need all of that, right? But we use that today, and it's not in conflict with God, in my opinion. So we in Christmas 2021, and most of you know this story, we launched Webb from French Guiana, South America. On Christmas morning, and that day, I haven't done a scientific survey, but I believe there were more people watching TV on Christmas morning than in the history of humankind. Yeah. Again, no survey, but I've gotten many small samples where people said, I got up early Christmas morning, got the kids up, got grandma up, and got a little breakfast going. And we turned on that TV. On Christmas morning, TV, I don't think it ever comes on in our house. Certainly with the grandkids, it definitely doesn't come on. So people had heard about this telescope. They'd heard that it was 100 times more powerful than the Hubble Space Telescope, which served us well. It was launched more than 30 years ago. Luckily, we were still using shuttle. We designed that for refurbishment, and we had 5 servicing missions. So it's still working today, and we're getting great, great data. But Webb is 100 times more powerful when you think about that. And you think about the infrared technology that allows us to see through the darkness and gulk and clouds of space. Many people have heard about and seen pictures of that 6.5-meter mirror. And you think of 6.5 meters, that's pretty big. It'll take up a nice chunk of this room here. And the tennis court size sun shield that allows one side of the telescope to stay nice and cold and look off into deep, dark space, and the other side where you have the electronics stay nice and warm and toasty facing the sun, the moon, and the earth. So people have heard about this and the greatness of this thing, and that's why so many people had those television sets on Christmas morning. And as Dr. Frederick mentioned earlier, Since revealing the first science images last July 12th, we've seen images of galaxies many billions of years ago, and many light years ago. And we're finding new galaxies all the time. We've seen exoplanet data. And exoplanet data allows us to look at planets that are around other stars that have similar orbits as Earth, similar size. And we can, with Webb, we can look at the element of those planets to see if they're potentially habitable. That will help us get closer to, are we alone? Now, many scientists will say there are hundreds of billions of galaxies in the universe, hundreds of billions. Think about that number. Our bank account's a long ways from that. So if you think of hundreds of billions, what's the probability of life somewhere else? Just doing the statistics. So we've learned a lot about exoplanets. We knew about them a little bit in the past two or three decades, but now we learned a lot. We're discovering them, but now we're actually peeking into these exoplanets. We're also looking at planets in our own universe, in our own solar system. We're looking at Jupiter's moons. We're looking at Mars, the weather on Mars, the seasonal activity on Mars. And we also can see the rings around Neptune. And that's Neptune, not Saturn. And another short story, I was giving a talk at an elementary school in Manassas last week, and I made those comments at this elementary school. And a little boy at the end raised his hand. He said, "You talked about rings around Neptune." He said, "You didn't mention the other planets that have rings." So, of course, I'm staring at him. So, where's this boy going? And he said, "Well, all the gas giants have rings." And I'm saying, "Who is this freaking kid?" I want to meet his mom and daddy. So, just from that one kid, I think future, we're in pretty good shape. Now, you know how you see universities recruiting basketball players out of elementary school and middle school. So I say we have to go recruit that kid for Howard University. So certainly Webb is the most powerful discoverer of our universe. We learned a lot about the human innovation. I mean, we did a lot there. It's half the size of, twice the size of Hubble, but half the mass. So a lot of innovation to make that happen, particularly with all of this added technology. So the capability is incredible. And we learn to explore in many powerful ways. A lot of that is learning how to work together. So more than 10,000 people around the globe. I think we touched 28 states. I may be off a few numbers. And numerous countries, certainly a lot of countries throughout Europe, to make this possible. So it's a lot of collaboration, learn how to deal with others, which oftentimes is harder than the technical stuff. And the technical stuff is quite complex. So we can learn how to live better together on Earth. And we were shown that when that telescope was flung to a million miles out from Earth on that Christmas morning. And again, I was pleased to take over Webb to get it over the goal line. It was a challenge. I was talking to one of the deans earlier, and we talked about art and science. There's a lot of science, but a whole lot of art that goes into that as well. And of course, you learn that along the way, certainly at places like Howard University. And for Webb, this is just the beginning. So kids all over the world will enjoy these images and all the data for many, many years to come. And Dr. Frederick, I'm probably confusing discussions. He and I talked a lot in the past few months. So we last time we talked a lot about the UARC that I mentioned earlier. And that designation, some of the importance is it allows for more scholarships, more fellowships, the ability to do more innovation, to do more research and exploration. and to help solve some of the nation's most challenging problems. And many of those problems, I'll just talk about space and aeronautics. That's my world. We're planning to send satellites to explore Venus, which scientists believe that Venus was habitable one day in the past, similar to Earth. We still believe there's ice water under the surface. So going to Venus, we're working on missions to go return samples from Mars. And we have rovers picking up samples today and putting them in tubes, laying them on the surface, and we're gonna go get those. It sounds simple, but it's not trivial. Flying in space is hazardous, it's tough, a lot of risk, costs a lot of money, unfortunately, but it does. We're also looking to send humans back to the surface of the moon, hopefully in this decade, and to have a sustained presence, not just go and come back. That takes a lot of work, a lot of innovation. You have to, in addition to a big rocket and a capsule, you have to have a lander once you get there. You can't land with that capsule. You need habitats, you need communications back to the capsule and hopefully back direct to Earth. And you need mobility, and the list goes on and on and on. So many opportunities for innovation. And hopefully we'll have humans to Mars in my lifetime. That's where my grandsons are really gonna pay their way. And hopefully some of the young folks in this room as well. That's a daunting task. We're building all electric aircraft. So just think all the fuel and things with climate going all electric. I know we have electric cars. Again, it's a huge leap to do all electric aircraft. So that work is going on. Looking at lowering the sonic boom. Some of the elders in here who remember the Concorde and some of the reasons it couldn't fly over populated areas because of that loud noise when it comes through the sound barrier. So a lot of work going on. That's just the tip of the iceberg, and that's just in space and aeronautics. There are many, many, many other areas where this UARC designation will really help do research and innovation, exploration, and there's a wealth of opportunity out there. And I often say, I guess a couple of years before the pandemic, I used to be on panels and called the future of work. And everyone was nipping around the edges of what that meant. Of course, we had a paradigm at the time. COVID shifted our paradigm. And always say the future of work is now. So we have to, as Marva Collins said, we have to start off today with the future in mind, with the end in mind. So a lot of opportunity through this UARC. Technology pace is extremely fast. We have quantum, we have metaverse, big data, data analytics, artificial intelligence, virtual reality, cyber, human machine learning, and human machine working, autonomous systems, systems of systems. And that's just, again, that's a short paragraph of a book of areas where we're gonna need innovative work in some of the technologies. And these things will go on into systems and also become consumer products. So how it would be in the lead of that, again, with the other universities that I mentioned. Shifting back to me, although there were numerous contributors to my career success, Howard University played a major, major role in that. The School of Engineering provided me with a lot of the fundamental subject matter expertise. I honed my collaboration skills here, working with diverse communities on and off campus. And that diverse community was different back then than it is today. But those opportunities are still there to hone in a diverse community. And Virginia Union, my first alma mater, and Howard University launched my global and self-awareness as a black man. So we grew up knowing who we are in our small environment, how we fit, kind of like we fit in the universe. But Howard and Virginia Union certainly took me a long ways in exploring who I really am, again, as a black man. And I've been on that journey ever since, and it's been a good journey, I might say. So how did we get here? So I gave you a little bit about how I got here. What about someone coming from New York City or a little island in the Caribbean? Someone from Los Angeles, Iowa, the motherland, the deep south, the northeast, the mid-Atlantic, Asia, the Middle East, and the list goes on. 53 states and territories and 53 nations. So Howard is poor from everywhere. But how did you get here? You have to keep asking that question, and again, that helps with going back to your roots. So in 1867, as I mentioned earlier, that was the first leg of this 4x4. I'm gonna stick to the 4x4 for now, but you can put it in any relay you want. They had to come out of the blocks at first runner. When you're coming out of the blocks, there's no running start. So those 150,000 people who were educated in those first 5 years, the people they were trying to catch up with were already gone because they had a running start for many, many years. That baton was handed off during Reconstruction. The baton was handed off during Jim Crow and the Civil Rights Movement. And yes, that baton was handed off to me to get Webb over the goal line. The anchor leg sometimes, for those who don't know, the anchor is the last leg. Sometimes they receive the baton, they're in the lead. Sometimes the anchor leg is a little behind when they receive that baton. Occasionally, you receive that baton, and if you've ever run, sometimes it's insurmountable. your possibility of winning when you get it, you're so far back. So each leg of that relay must run like there's no tomorrow, whether you get it in the lead, a little behind, or insurmountable odds. And when you run like there's no tomorrow, everyone who had that baton before you will cheer you on to victory. So, question for you, are you prepared to take that baton? I don't care how you get here. Just get here if you can. And Howard University will certainly do the rest. Thank you.
The Howard University Chorale will perform Sooner Will Be Done, arranged by William L. Dawson and conducted by Dr. Poole.
No more women in a way, no more women in a way. troubles of the world, troubles of the world, the troubles of the world. Soon we'll be done with the troubles of the world, going home to live with God. Soon we'll be done with the troubles of the world, troubles of the world, the troubles of the world. Soon we'll be done with the troubles of the world, going home to live with God. I want to meet my Jesus.
We'll now hear the closing remarks and benediction. Please welcome President Frederick.
So let's give another round of applause for our orator, Dr. Robinson. And let's also acknowledge the choir once again. Absolutely fantastic. I want to acknowledge the Board of Trustees, and amongst the Board of Trustees, we have our newest trustee, Trustee Kevin Lofton, who is a former CEO of Howard University Hospital way back in the day. And if the Board of Trustees can stand so that we can acknowledge you, all of the board, thank you. I also want to take an opportunity to acknowledge the deans. If you can all stand. The 2023 class of Distinguished Postgraduate Achievement Award recipients who will be honored during our Charter Day evening tomorrow include Edward E. Cornwell in the field of medicine. If you can stand. Lillian Lincoln Lambert in the field of business. They all have incredible stories. Michelle Miller is with us. Michelle Miller in the field of journalism. And we have, obviously, we'll honor Dr. Robinson again tomorrow night. Louis Thigpen in the field of engineering. And Melissa Yamba Butler in the field of art. So please give them a warm round of applause. Tomorrow night's recipient of the 2023 LaRue V. Barkwell Capstone Distinguished Service Award will go to Anita English. I want to acknowledge Dr. Marcus Alfred, the chair of the Howard University Faculty Senate, who's with us today. Dr. Candace Harris, the president of the Howard University Alumni Association. Ms. Mary Jones Bryant and the retirees of Howard University. And if there are any retirees in the audience, if you can stand so that we can acknowledge you. Ms. Jordan Allen, the president of the Howard University Student Association. Oh, she left to go to class, I apologize. Actually, I don't apologize, that's a good sign. I'd like to acknowledge the Royal Court, if you can stand so that we can acknowledge you. The members of our distinguished faculty, if you can all stand so we can give you a round of applause for what you do. The staff of Howard University, all the staff members who are here today joining us, if you can stand and be acknowledged. Ms. Monique McClung, the president of the Howard University staff organization, is here as well. The alumni of Howard University, if you're in the house, if you can stand and give yourself a big round of applause. You know, at one of our brother colleges, there's a saying that you can tell a Morehouse man, you just can't tell him anything. We're gonna have to come up with something for the Howard alum. I have something, but I'll share it tomorrow night. I do wanna acknowledge my former chief of staff, who's now working with the Department of Justice, and he's here with us today, Mr. Paul Montero. And again, I wanna take an opportunity, the artistic director of the choir, Dr. Eric Poole, has just done a fantastic job at these. So between him and the student performer. And I want to thank Simone for joining me on this crazy journey. Appreciate you. Howard is in a very special moment, and the trajectory of this great university is ceilingless. The only thing that is going to keep Howard back is ourselves. We have a grave responsibility to work together, to collaborate. The external forces are there. They are what they are, some known, some unknown. But the one thing we must not do is get in our own way or get in each other's way. And so I certainly charge all of us with taking that sacred obligation that we have to make this world a better place, to make sure that we first make each other better and provide each other with the kind of support that we should be providing. So now let's join together in singing the Alma Mater and remain standing for the benediction to be delivered by the Reverend Dr. Bernard L. Richardson. After the benediction, please remain standing for the retiring of the colors, followed by the recessional.
Yeah.
Richardson.
Let us pray. We thank you, O God, for what eyes have seen. We thank you for what our ears have heard. We thank you for what our hearts have felt. We thank you for the presidency of Rain Frederick. And now I said to the one who stood at the gate, give me a light that I may go out into the darkness and into the unknown. And she replied to me, go out into the darkness, go out into the unknown, but put your hand in the hand of God, and God shall be for you better than light and much safer than a known way. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Please remain standing for the retiring of the colors. You are reminded that these proceedings were live streamed on Howard University's YouTube channel. Please note this ceremony will re-air on WHUT Saturday, March 11th.
So, I'm sorry, if you can hold the music for 1 second. It's tough to control the voice of God. I wasn't sure what to call you. I apologize. Awkward moment. My phone is blowing up, and I have a feeling that that's Jordan Allen texting me to tell me that I didn't shout out the students. So before we leave here, let's get a big round of applause for the Howard University students. H-U.
And again, we thank you for being our guest at the 2023 Charter Day. Thank you again for being our guest at the 2023 Charter Day Convocation, commemorating the 156th anniversary of the historic founding of Howard University. Good day.